वेलकम स्टूडेंट्स, नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक ऑफ रीनल स्टोन्स. दिस टॉपिक कैरीज अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग और अ राइटर फैसिनेटिंग पैथोफिजियोलॉजी. वन नीड्स टू अंडरस्टैंड वेरी केयरफुली बिफोर अटेम्प्टिंग एनी क्वेश्चंस रिलेटेड टू दीज स्टोन्स. नाउ यूरिन विल बी हैविंग वेरियस इन्ग्रीडियंट्स एंड डिपेंडिंग ऑन द स्टैसिस which is a very important factor towards formation of renal stones, urine will form three different zones. In a test tube, for example, if you take sample of urine and allow it to wait for some time, there will be eventually various zones one can observe into it. Scientists have studied this special phenomenon and they have divided into three distinct zones. One is unstable zone, second is a metastable zone, and third is a stable zone. I will show you one diagram which will give you a better idea about this concept. This first diagram will give you three different zones. The uppermost zone is a normal urinary zone, which will also look to the naked eye as a normal urine, which is actually an unstable zone because it is in the process of eventually forming into next zone. Second zone is a zone of saturation, or we call it as stable zone, where there is starting of crystal formation and eventually these crystals will get aggregated and form into a little larger stone. Lastly, or the bottommost, is the zone of supersaturation or metastable zone, which will definitely show aggregation of various forms of crystals and minute stone formations, which if it continues will form little larger stone. Now there are various processes which enhance this stone formation. There are process of crystallization, which especially occurs in a zone of supersaturation. Then there is a phenomenon of epitaxy. Now epitaxy is nothing but deposition of one type of crystals over another type of crystals. Lastly, there is inhibitor lag, which can be due to organic or inorganic in nature. Organic, absence of uromucoid, citrate, peptide factor A can eventually lead to supersaturation and eventually stone formation. Inorganic inhibitor lag, such as zinc and magnesium, will definitely precipitate into stone formation. Now I will give you one more diagram which will give you better idea about this phenomenon of epitaxy and earlier process of stone formation. Now this small diagram will give you an outline. Central portion is nucleus or a nidus, or in simple words is a focus around which stone crystals are deposited. So one set of crystals will get deposited on the surface of this nidus and subsequently another set. This slide will give you an outline about various contributory factors related to formation of stone. First and foremost, most important is a stasis, that is simple stagnation of urine in particular time. Now this stagnation will eventually lead to various zones. Second is dietary, that is lack of peptide factors A or other important inorganic substances such as zinc and magnesium. Few metabolic factors. Then change in a urinary pH is also important. Now, as you are aware, that few crystals will be getting deposited into alkaline urine and few will be in acidic urine, which we will see eventually. Temperature change will also influence stone formation. Inhibitor lag will definitely precipitate stone. Urinary saturation is also very, very important, which we have already seen. And various types of infection or infective nidus will be directly contributory towards stone formation. Next, we'll see types of stones that we encounter in the urinary system. Most common are the calcium stones. They also occur in combination with other substances such as calcium oxalate, calcium phosphate. All calcium stones are radio opaque As we are aware that 80 to 85% of the urinary stones are radiopaque in nature, and only 10 to 15% of the stones are radiolucent, which will be seen as a filling defect in the plain X-ray. Now, what is important for us to know? Calcium contributes to the main radioopacity of this shadow. Second type is phosphate stones. Phosphate stones are usually seen in some combination such as ammonium magnesium phosphate or triple phosphate. Now, this is very important for you to know. Sometimes an MCQ can come which will tell you about what is triple phosphate, what is the combination. So you should know ammonium magnesium phosphate or AMP, very simple to remember, also called as struvite stones. These are very hard stones. They are not so common, but when formed are very hard and radiopaque stones. Third type is uric acid, which are less common and radiolucent. Next is infective stones, typically formed around an infective nidus or infective focus. Various microorganisms can be detected on stone analysis. Next set is the cystine stones. In cystine stones, they are usually hexagonal in crystal formation. They are translucent and they usually are formed in acidic urine. This is again very important for you to remember for an MCQ. Pure oxalate stones are again rare, and xanthine will have a lamellated appearance on stone analysis in cross section. Clinical features. Now, these renal stones will give rise to various clinical features. First, we have to understand the primary clinical features or primary effects and the secondary effects. Primary effects: a patient will have fixed renal pain at renal angle. Second, eventually, patient will have hematuria. Now, we have already seen various causes of hematuria. Here, the hematuria is typically painful, which you have to distinguish from painless hematuria, which is classically seen in malignancy. Fever can sometimes be associated and will indicate infection in the urinary tract. Patient may have swelling in the loin, which can be due to simple obstruction leading to eventual hydronephrosis. And few patients will have urinary infection leading to pyuria or sepsis. Secondary clinical features due to renal stones can be edema fit, chronic renal failure, and non-functioning kidney. This edema fit is basically related to nephrotic syndrome. When there is a lot of proteinuria, one can actually detect albumins and prealbumins in the urine rotating microscopy. There can be a few complications associated with renal stones, such as staghorn formation. Staghorn is nothing but a temporary phenomenon in which stone will eventually grow into various pelvic alveolar system and take a shape of horn of a stag. That's why the name is given staghorn. The implications of knowing staghorn or having a staghorn is patient will have hydronephrosis due to obstruction leading to blockage to urinary outflow. Patient will have upper urinary tract infection. Patient will eventually have pyonephrosis and pyelonephritis. All these things are associated with staghorn stone formation. There can be sometimes anemia because a patient is having painless hematuria. Rarely, there can be one more entity, that is xanthogranulomatous pyelonephritis. In this particular pathology, the kidney and its fascia will have lot of adhesions, and radiologically or sonologically it will mimic like a malignancy, but again it's a benign condition. Rarely, the last and rare complication is a squamous metaplasia, which will lead to formation of squamous cell carcinoma. Now we will look at a differential diagnosis associated with renal stones. Now, if we have renal stones, every time a radiopaque shadow, suppose we get one X-ray and we see a radiopaque shadow, so every time it need not be a renal stone. One should be aware that there can be another associated clinical factor which can mimic like a renal stone, such as gallstones. Now, how to differentiate or how to remove this dilemma is take a lateral picture or a lateral x-ray. If the radiopaque shadow lies behind the vertebral column, because kidney is retroperitoneal structure, it will confirm your diagnosis of renal stone against a gallstone when the shadow will be predominantly in front of the vertebral column on lateral profile. Second, calcific mesenteric lymph nodes. These shadows will be in the center of the abdominal plate, not at the level of the kidney or not paramedian. Third thing can be either retained tablets or some foreign body ingested by the patient. Sometimes flebolins can also mimic like renal stones. Very often one can find a ossified tip of the 12th rib as a radiopaque shadow and get confused with the renal stone. But if you look at it very carefully, it will be seen bilaterally. This is a phenomenon which is age related. Usually above age of 50 years, one can have ossification of 11th, 10th, 12th ribs. Then a calcified TB node, lymph node, can also mimic like renal stone. And lastly, adrenal or suprarenal calcifications, either in patchy form or intra-adrenal gland, can undergo ossification and actually mimic renal stone. Now in this situation, it is very difficult to differentiate from the renal stone because it is in close proximity with kidney. But if you do a CT scan or a specialized study, one can actually differentiate it from the true renal stone. Now we'll look at the investigations with renal stones. There are various biochemical investigations such as complete blood count, urine rutile microscopy most important. It will show various crystal formations, various microorganisms, various casts, various debris. Urine culture sensitivity to pick up the infection. Renal function tests are very crucial, BUN and creatinine, because renal stones with some obstructive features will have some renal compromise and patient will have some sort of renal failure. Of course, this will be a chronic renal failure, so creatinine will rise slowly. Usually these patients are elderly, so one needs to do for a fasting or post-lunch blood sugar, or sometimes even random blood sugar. Chemically, what is important is serum calcium levels, because as you are aware that majority of the stones are calcium stones. Then serum uric acid levels and serum phosphate levels. Next investigative modality is radiological, in which first and foremost is ultrasonography of abdomen and pelvis will give rise to various anatomical features of the kidney, such as increased size or any hydronephrosis or any hydroureter or hydropelvis, plus presence of radiopaque calculus in the kidney. Intravenous urography is again considered as a gold standard, which will show a radiopaque shadow on a pilot plate. Now you have to understand, in IVU there are two things. First, we take a pilot film or a scout film. This is a base plate which will actually determine whether the patient is ready to go further and undergo intravenous urography procedure or we have to abandon it. The purpose of doing this scout film or pelvic plate, or we call it as a pilot plate, is to rule out any gaseous shadow in the colon, because those shadows are actually going to overlap the kidney shadow and sometimes the horstrations can mimic like small stones. So one needs to be very sure that the patient has undergone good bowel preparation. That's why scout film. Plus, as you are aware, 85% of the stones are radiopaque. Those are also picked up on this pilot plate. And if the preparation is good, definitely the patient can go forward and do the complete IVU. In the IVU, the typical stone will be seen as a radiolucent defect and not a radiopaque shadow. One needs to understand. This question can come in MCQ, that how does the stone will look in the IVU? It will be like a shadow and not a radiopaque calculus. Some special studies are also advocated, like a CT scan, abdomen and pelvis. It actually virtually replaces the IVU, but reserved for complex cases when the straightforward IVU is not helpful. DTPA renogram, as one is aware that a few patients may come with urosepsis or with renal failure, for them to have a better delineation of the functionality of the kidney, one needs to do a renal scan, that is a DTPA renal scan, which will show how much kidney one can preserve, or if it is non-functioning kidney, one needs to remove it. Then post-surgery or post-procedural, there are certain investigations which are important during this renal stone study, is stone analysis. This is basically done for metabolic evaluation of the patient. Now, why it is important? Suppose you remove the stone and patient goes home. What's wrong? What happens? You have to understand the root cause, why the stones are happening to the patient. For example, patient has a pituitary tumor which is secreting excess of calcium. Patient has calcium stones, you remove the stone, patient goes home. Again, after 2 years, patient comes back to you with stone formation. You remove it, again you send the patient. So this entire sequence continues. You don't want to fall into this vicious cycle. That is why it's very important to find the root cause, why it is happening. Sometimes a parathyroid adenoma can give rise to calcium stones. So it's very important that you first locate the root cause and eliminate it so as to prevent a recurrence of the stone formation. That is why this metabolic evaluation is very, very important post-procedure. It is of two types. One is a quantitative and one is a qualitative form. In qualitative, there can be gas or liquid chromatography. And in quantitative, one needs to have a spectroscopic evaluation of the stone. Now we need to understand certain special conditions associated with this stone disease. What to do when stones are associated in children? Usually, there are better treatment modalities available to us with which we can treat these children. In children, the majority cause is some endocrinal problem such as parathyroid adenoma or some metabolic disease that needs to be catered than just treating the stones. Recurrent stone disease, again important, find a root cause, treat it first and then go for stone disease. Bilateral stones. Now here is very clinical challenge for urologist or a surgeon, how to treat bilateral stones. Very important one needs to understand, the kidney which is compromised and with lesser function is treated first. The kidney with a better function, less compromise, can have some time to breathe. But the affected kidney, which is at the brink of going into failure, needs to be treated first, remove the obstruction by good methods available to us, and try to salvage the kidney. If you just treat the better functioning kidney, what will happen? The lesser functioning kidney will further deteriorate and will eventually land in failure, which is not good. So bilateral stone imposes a clinical challenge for urologists and to surgeons. Medically active stone disease. What is that? It means increase in a stone size, then passage of crystals or casts or gravels in the urine, and a known metabolic disease to the patient, such as patient has hypercalcemia. You know it, then you have to treat it. It's very important. Not just treat the effect, but treat the cause also. Now we'll look into treatment options for renal stones. Medical versus surgical. Medical, that is conservative. Indications are stones which are less than 5 mm in diameter can undergo conservative line of treatment or medical treatment. And patient should have normal renal function tests. Now what advice do we give to our patients? Patients should drink plenty of oral fluids. That is first and foremost care they need to take. If you take a history detail, they will tell you that they are consuming less and less water for some unknown reasons. So it's very important they should at least consume 3 to 4 liters of potable water per day. Second, for recurrent stone patients or for certain special calcium stone patients, they need to avoid vegetables like spinach, seeded vegetables like brinjal, cucumber, etc. Then one needs to alkalinize urine with potassium citrate solutions so as to minimize the crystallization and formation of various zones of saturation and supersaturation. Then dairy products need to be restricted for patients with calcium stones. It's very important that patients should be aware that too much consumption of dairy product will eventually have calcium deposition and calcium stone and calciuria. Now the surgical options. Surgical options classically of again two types. One is open method versus endoscopic retrieval. In open method, what options do we have? One can do a pyelolithotomy, that is opening of the renal pelvis and extraction of the renal stone under vision. We usually go by posterior approach and sometimes from the lateral approach, and we remove the stone. This is an extraperitoneal approach. We need not open the peritoneum, but the kidney is handled, ureter's fascia is opened slowly, and under vision renal pelvis is identified, ureter is hooked up and stone is extracted, and the defect is sutured under vision. Sometimes for a larger stone, we need to extend our incision under the pelvis, then we call it as extended pyelolithotomy or Gill-Vernet's modification of standard pyelolithotomy. It is sometimes useful that we have to do a Gill-Vernet's maneuver for actually accessing the renal pelvis, because sometimes the renal pelvis can be intrarenal. Now this intrarenal renal pelvis poses a crucial challenge for the operating surgeon to extract the stone. So we need to have a Gill-Vernet's maneuver so as to expose the renal pelvis and then go inside and extract the stone. Sometimes the stone is lodged deep inside the renal parenchyma, in the renal papilla or in parenchyma. At that time, there is no role for pyelolithotomy, but we need to do what is known as a nephrolithotomy, that is marking incision on the renal tissue or renal parenchyma. Now, as we have already discussed about the renal anatomy, posteriorly there is a Braudel's line. Max Braudel described it, which is a plane of relatively avascularity. One can actually go through this particular zone and go and remove the stone. But these are again open methods. Patient will have a larger scar. Of course, 100% cure is usually possible because you are actually removing stones and fragments under vision. You can give a good lavage to the residual collecting system and ensure 100% evacuation of the stone. But nowadays, patients, because of the pain factor, these incisions, being large incisions, are actually painful, and they are actually on the lateral aspect or on the posterior aspect, which will have a different posture post-surgically for these patients. That is why nowadays we avoid it doing it unless it's a very large stone load. Endoscopically, what options do we have? Endoscopically, we have a very good option, that is a PCNL, that is percutaneous nephrolithotomy. We take a loin approach, we reach the renal pelvis and we break the stones or fragment the stones and extract it under vision with the use of baskets. Sometimes the stone is lodged at the pelvic-ureteric junction. Still one can manage it with the help of URS, that is a ureterorhinoscopy. We take a cystoscopic approach, pass a ureteroscope up in the ureter, under vision, dilate it and remove the stone. The newer modality of treatment is use of shock waves, or in other technical terms we call it as ESWL or electrohydraulic lithotripsy. Now for this lithotripsy, various energy sources are used, such as electrohydraulic, electromagnetic, ultrasonic or piezoelectric. Now the aim of these various sources is to generate a sound wave or a mechanical wave which is going to bombard the stone and actually culled the stone. But the stone culling is a different process. As you are aware, once the stone is hit with the waves, the stone is going to shatter for some time. Now this shattering to and fro is going to separate various stone fragments and various layers or various zones of the stone, and eventually it will break down into like a sand or various small fragments. So the stones are culled through this technique, not just 100% broken or fragmented like a blast. And eventually it will have very small fragmentation and lot of gravels. It's a very effective method. But what is important for doing the PCNL or ESWL, that pre-procedure, patient should have a stent in the ureter. The ureter or the drainage passage needs to be patent before performing ESWL or PCNL. Otherwise, what will happen? You will fragment the stone, but the entire ureter can get just blocked with a gravel, because as you are aware, ureter is a dynamic structure. It undergoes peristalsis. It is not just a solid tube. So as the peristalsis will pass, some of the gravel actually can get impinged into ureteric muscular wall and impose a more threat than the initial threat, because this will be extremely painful condition. Especially when you have ureteric colic, we don't want that to happen. That's why the ureter needs to be patent. So whatever gravel or stone can actually pass through the patent ureter into the bladder, and after bladder, yes, patient will be definitely able to pass the gravel or the remaining sand of stone through urethra. If the stones are retained at various levels in the ureter, it is called as stain strass. It is a French word which means stone street, or in X-ray one can have actually formation of various stone pathway along the entire course of ureter, just because the surgeon or the urologist has failed to put a simple stenting in the ureter. Occasionally, for large stones, a few urologists take a double technique, or we call it sandwich technique, in which through PCN, first we break the stone, make it into, suppose the stone is of 3 cm, we make it into 3 fragments of 1 cm each, then we apply ESWL for this patient, fragment it further into 0.5 or 0.8 mm into 10 to 12 fragments, again we apply PCN, and then we extract under vigil or under radiographic control. So we ensure 100% evacuation for even larger stone. So previously we would have actually subjected this patient for open surgery, but now it's possible that with the sandwich technique or combined modality of treatment, we can actually take care of the stone disease no matter how big it is, with minimal access, that is through PCNL plus combination of PCNL plus ESWL.